This issue has been on my radar for a long time. I, like most people my age, have a cholesterol count that's higher than mainstream medicine says it should be. My doctor, who is a dear friend and an extremely intelligent man, but he's old school when it comes to this stuff, has been, every time I take a physical, tries to get me on statins. I've refused so far. Something doesn't sound right about it to me. I've got a gut feeling. A member of my family has relented and is doing it. I think he's making a mistake. And now more comes out, a new book called The Great Cholesterol Myth. So let's talk about the cholesterol myth. Book was written by Dr. Jonny Bowden, who is a Ph.D., nationally known expert on weight loss and nutrition. He has a master's degree in psychology and counseling, a Ph.D. in nutrition, board certified by the American College of Nutrition, 6 national certifications in personal training, author of 12 books, including this one, which he wrote along with Dr. Steven Sinatra, who's a board-certified cardiologist, nutritionist, and anti-aging specialist specializing in integrated medicine. So, Dr. Bowden, it is a real pleasure to have you with us. Thanks for joining us on the Dennis Prager Show.
Hi, Mark. It's great to be here, and please call me Johnny.
Okay, Johnny. Thank you. The first thing that jumped out at me as I saw your book, I'm thinking, you know, we've been on statin drugs and aggressive pharmaceutical medicines now for I don't know, maybe decades, and yet cardiovascular disease is still the most pervasive killer in Western society. So it obviously isn't working, is it?
It's obviously not working. By the way, your gut instinct was correct. I heard what you said about your doctor wanting to put you on a statin drug. Hmm. If you haven't had a heart attack, Mark, if you do not have current cardiovascular disease and you're a middle-aged man, you have no business on a statin drug. If you're a woman, you have no business on a statin drug. And God knows, if you're a child, you have no business on a statin drug.
Yeah, I heard about that. It was shocking that there are many who are promoting putting children on these drugs.
It's a multi-million dollar campaign. It's insidious. It's going on right now. You will see more and more things coming out. They are funded by the pharmaceutical industry, and this is literally an opportunity for them to expand their customer base by about 11 million people. I'm sure the stockholders will be very happy with that, but the kids who are put on these drugs, it will be the next thalidomide waiting to happen.
I believe that. Now, let's say for 20 years, maybe longer, we've been told that heart disease is caused by cholesterol. In fact, that was one of the reasons we had the big egg scare years ago, eggs full of cholesterol, so eating them was clogging your arteries and killing you. So first, Johnny, let's clear up the mystery of cholesterol, because from what we've been led to believe, there's nothing good about it. In fact, I was thinking about the song War, what is it good for? I'm thinking, cholesterol, what is it good for? Absolutely nothing. Say it again.
Well, actually, that's very funny. Actually, speaking of old paradigms like that, you probably have seen those ads of this is your drug on your brain on drugs with the frying eggs. When I do lectures and workshops on this, I often show a large balloon, and I say, this is your cell on cholesterol. This is your body on cholesterol. And then I pop the balloon and say, and this is what it's like without cholesterol. Cholesterol is an absolutely necessary and important molecule. It's used for brain health, for thinking, for fighting infections, for making bile acids. You make vitamin D from cholesterol. And most important, you make all, and this gets everyone's attention, all your sex hormones from cholesterol, including estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone. I don't think it's any coincidence that in the last 20 to 30 years, when we have been on this obsessive and ill-advised a passion to lower cholesterol, that there's also been an epidemic of erectile dysfunction. I do not think that's
interesting.
A coincidence.
Yeah. That's very, you see, you got everybody's attention now.
Yeah, that always gets everybody's attention.
Fix your sex life, and all of a sudden, now the volume controls all went up. Mm-hmm. No, that's an interesting correlation there. That along with this whole thing of a super low fat diet and lowering. I remember that one time back, I think it was in the 70s, I was buying into this, and I worked, and I remember I got my cholesterol down, I think, to 165, and I was so proud, but that was probably the hardest work I ever did in my life, and I didn't feel particularly good, and I knew something wasn't right.
Well, you know, what's interesting about this, there's just so much to unpack about these myths about cholesterol, but one of them is that the lower, the better. In fact, when you start to get really low, your risk for death from all sorts of other things begins to go up. For example, accidents and suicides. Now, why would there be more accidents and suicides in very low cholesterol populations? I'll tell you why. Because cholesterol is needed for the brain. Because cholesterol is needed for thinking and for mood. And to artificially lower this vital molecule especially when there's no heart disease and there's no real correlation between cholesterol and heart disease. And I'd like to talk about that in a minute. Sure. To continue to do this in the face of all this is just sheer madness. It's just sheer madness. I am very convinced that 50 years from now, when we look back at this model of treatment of heart disease and we see this obsessive concentration on this innocuous molecule and taking our eyes off the ball of the real causes of heart disease, we will look back on this. We won't be around, but they will look back on this and they will say, what were they thinking?
Yeah, and you pointed out in the book, too, that most people think of, you know, cholesterol, it shortens your life, and you're saying, no, it protects against a lot of diseases and problems, and actually, I would assume it with the right amount of cholesterol, can prolong your life.
Well, the data is very clear on that. The people in the Framingham study with the highest cholesterol lived the longest, so high cholesterol is actually protective in older people. But here's what's really interesting. This is the part that people just fall off their chairs when they hear. Cholesterol is not even a good predictor of heart disease. Over 50% of people who are admitted to hospitals in the United States with cardiovascular disease have normal cholesterol, and over half the people with quote-unquote elevated cholesterol have normal hearts. It doesn't even predict the thing we're trying to prevent.
It got my attention back. This may have been 15, 20, maybe 20 years ago. And he was a famous long-distance runner who had really low cholesterol. He had a straight Jim, that's right, Mr. Fix. He had a low, he stayed on the super low,
low fat diet, low cholesterol diet while he was running in the
dropped dead of a heart attack and nothing predicted. So, yeah.
Now, obviously, one case like that does not make a scientific study. We know that. And Tim Russett, you know, God bless him, he died, you know, on the treadmill at NBC, also very well managed on statin drugs. So, you know, if one case never makes a study. But there's so much data on this. That lowering cholesterol does not prevent heart disease. And as I said on the Dr. Oz show, I said that trying to prevent heart disease by lowering cholesterol is like trying to lower your caloric intake by taking the lettuce off your plate at McDonald's. I mean, sure, the lettuce has a couple of calories, but when you're looking at a double-sized chocolate milkshake and double-sized, super-sized French fries, is the lettuce the target you really want to aim at? Really?
Yeah. Hey, folks, if you want to weigh in, and I see people lined up, 1-8-PRAGER-777-6. One, let me ask you this. I got a lot to get to, but I want one doctor had mentioned to me that he thought that I think the age he said was 50, maybe 55. He said that older men, that the cholesterol count had absolutely no bearing on heart disease or mortality. And does this apply to everyone, or was he right about older men?
He's right about everybody, actually.
Okay.
It's a very poor correlation with heart disease. Now, there's 100 reasons, and we could talk about them indefinitely, how we got on this track, how we came to believe this, how this became a cultural meme, so that when you question it, they look at you like you're hearing voices through the fillings in your teeth. It's definitely, certainly, a widely held belief, but it's wrong. And it's been wrong all along.
Right. It's widely held and even passionately, I guess, because people have heard it so long, because as I have brought up this discussion with people, they almost get upset.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, oh no, not possible.
Yeah.
The idea that I eat eggs for breakfast rather than having, you know, watch these commercials where we're eating all these whole grains, that's what most of my friends would do, and they're shocked that I eat eggs for breakfast.
Yeah, and it's a very healthy breakfast indeed. You know, I got into this, Mark. It may be interesting to some people. I was very much a cholesterol believer. I started my career in health and fitness in 1990 as a personal trainer. I learned the same nutrition information everybody else learned. I learned it through the god-awful American Dietetic Association, and I got the same kind of low-fat aerobic exercise, you know, cut the fat, especially saturated fat's going to kill you, and that was the advice we gave to clients, and I believed it, and my co-author, Steve Sinatra, was also a choir boy for statin drugs. He was paid honorariums by Merck and Pfizer to actually lecture to doctors and tell them how wonderful statin drugs were. So we were both kind of believers. Of what I noticed as a personal trainer and a nutritionist, not a doctor, but a nutritionist, I noticed that my clients would sometimes defy my advice and go on something like the Atkins diet, which, of course, we all thought was just crazy. And,
right.
You know, you're eating all that bacon and eggs and pork rinds, you're going to die. And we would watch this in horror, except that not only would they lose weight, they'd come back with improved blood tests, and they were not dying.
Hey, listen, Jonny, hang on one sec. I got a hard break. I want you to continue that very thought. We're just going to take a break and be right back. All right, folks, Dennis Prager Show at 1-8-PRAGER-776. Mark Taylor for Dennis. Those of you waiting on the phone, just be patient. There's a lot of you want to ask questions. I'll get to you momentarily. Dr. Jonny Bowden is with me now, the co-author of The Great Cholesterol Myth, along with Dr. Steven Sinatra. I love that name, Dr. Sinatra. I mean, you can't help but, whoa. Anyway, that's an aside. You were mentioning, Jonny, before we went to the break, that back when you were believing that cholesterol was the big culprit, that you'd watch folks go on like the Atkins diet of high fat and protein, and nothing happened. I had a similar thing that kind of began my awakening. It dawned on me that, because when I was talking about low fat, we really tried to make it as fat free as possible. I mean, you eliminated fat everywhere you could. And it dawned on me that I was eliminating a whole food group from it. Just something told me that wasn't right. And then I started watching my grandfather, who was 94 years old. He was a trim man, always active, but he ate the whole thing. He ate the eggs and bacon, the occasional steak. He would have, you know, chicken, everything. Mm-hmm. And 94 years old. Now, granted, he died of a heart attack at 94. But it's kind of like Larry the Cable Guy. When somebody asks, what did his 101-year-old grandmother die of? And he said, she was old. You know, my grandfather was old. That's a long lifespan.
Yeah.
This leads me to another subject. The one thing I remember he rarely ate was sugar.
Well, you've kind of got to the punchline early, and I'm very glad that you did. People often ask me, because I've been a huge proselytizer, if you will, for the lower carb approach, the Paleolithic approach to eating, the higher fat, higher protein, lower carb approach. And people often say to me, well, how do you explain that in China they eat white rice and they don't have heart disease, or people seem to sometimes get better on vegan diets? And I explain it very simply. What the vegan diet and the raw food diet and the Atkins diet and all of these different things that are at the extremes of the continuum have in common is that they don't have sugar. That is the distinguishing feature. They don't have massive amounts of fructose, which is metabolic poison. So whether you're avoiding that through a high-protein, high-fat diet or through a vegan diet very high in vegetables and absent of sugar, either way, you're omitting the one ingredient that actually is at the scene of the crime when it comes to heart disease, and that is sugar.
And more specifically, would it be fructose?
Fructose is the damaging part of sugar, Mark. Glucose, table sugar, the stuff that you put in your coffee that's in the diner in the little sugar bowl, that's 50% fructose, 50% glucose. It's the fructose part that's damaging. Sadly, the apologists for high fructose corn syrup, the Corn Refiners Association, they're saying, hey, this is no worse than sugar. They're actually right. But that's like kind of like saying Montezuma's revenge is no worse than chronic diarrhea. They're both horrible. And the extra 5% of fructose in high fructose corn syrup doesn't make that much difference. It's the fructose that is the problem.
Yeah, and and that's something, and I don't want to get off on that tangent, although I believe for a long time that the high fructose corn syrup was making people obese. And apparently, according to you, I'm assuming giving them heart disease as well. So all across the board, I've always felt there was a problem with this thing, and it appears that's being confirmed.
Well, you know what? Here's what's interesting, Mark. We talk about in The Great Cholesterol Myth how this myth, you know, came to be a kind of general policy of all the major medical organizations and the government. And your audience knows probably better than anybody that we can't always trust the government to get absolutely accurate advice. Well, it's never been more true than in cholesterol, low-fat diets, and the like. The interesting thing here is if you go back and trace how this thing just became the juggernaut that it was, there were two competing theories back in the 70s about what was tracking with heart disease, you know, when you looked at the epidemiological studies. One of the theories put forth by Ansel Keys was that it was fat and cholesterol. The other theory, put forth by a wonderful physician in England named John Yudkin, was that it was sugar, that sugar tracked with heart disease far better. And these two academics battled it out, and it was as contentious as the U.S. Congress. But somehow Keyes prevailed and got his theory accepted. The wrong theory won. It's been sugar all along. And the interesting thing is sugar and fat usually travel together in the American diet, in the westernized diet. They're usually found together. We have blamed fat wrongly. Fat is the innocent bystander. It's been sugar all along.
Let me go with the phones at 1-8-PRAGER-776. Mike in Warren, Michigan is joining us right now. Hey, welcome, Mike. You're with Mark Taylor and Dr. Jonny Bowden.
Welcome you both. Yeah, my chiropractor has got me on a half-fat and half-cholesterol diet because he says your brain is half-fat, half-cholesterol. It's omega-3. And he said that the omega-6 is what's making the Americans obese because we got cattle being fed grain, which is an omega-6, and that's adding weight to our body that's unnecessary.
Your chiropractor.
I was just wondering if omega-6 is correct of what he's talking about, because the fructose corn syrup, I agree 100% with you.
Well, your chiropractor is absolutely right, and let me explain why. There are two essential fatty acids that our body needs, omega-6 and omega-3. Omega-6 is found in vegetable oils, canola oil and soybean oil and cottonseed oil and all of the oils you've been told to eat so much of, and omega-3s are found in fish. Flaxseed is a plant source of them. Grass-fed beef has a lot of omega-3s. Now, we need both. But here's the problem. Your body makes two sets of nutrients, anti-inflammatory and inflammatory. Now, a lot of people say to me, well, why do we need the inflammatory? Well, because it's part of the healing process. If you get a splinter in your toe, it swells up because white blood cells go and surround the area and prevent an infection or a microbe from getting a hold. And so we need some degree of inflammation in order to heal from an injury. The problem is we've got these two armies, inflammation army and the anti-inflammation army, and we're funding the inflammatory army to the tune of 1,600% higher than we're funding the anti-inflammatory army. We should be consuming our omega-6s and our omega-3s in a 1-to-1 ratio. We're consuming them in a 16-to-1 ratio. So the omega-6s are, in fact, it's not that they're bad. It's that they're totally out of whack and out of balance for the way the body actually functions. What we need is about a 1-to-1 ratio. When we eat all that vegetable oil that we've been told to substitute for saturated fat, we create inflammation because we're literally giving the body the building blocks of the inflammatory compounds that it sends out. And that's a terrible state. So your chiropractor is absolutely right. Since inflammation is the real cause of heart disease, what sense does it make to eat 16 times as many pro-inflammatory fats as anti-inflammatory fats?
Yeah, Jonny, let me ask you this then. As far as omega-3s then, what is, I'm assuming the best way is by eating it, but do you suggest taking supplements?
We talk about the natural supplement, the supplements and foods that are very heart protective and heart disease preventive. And at the top of that list is omega-3s. I believe everybody in America should be on omega-3 supplementation. There are some other supplements that are extremely healthy for the heart and extremely protective of the heart, the vascular system, the cells. And we can certainly talk about those, but omega-3s would be at the top of the list for me.
Just to be practical here, does it matter if you take them in a pill form or a liquid form?
You get a bigger bang for your buck in the liquid form because you can get so much more of a dosage with one teaspoon or one tablespoon than you can get from a pill. But no, in terms of how the body processes them, no difference whatsoever.
All right. Dr. Jonny Bowden is with us now. He, along with Dr. Stephen Sinatra, have written the book, The Great Cholesterol Myth, which is just out. And one of the things we're learning is that cholesterol is not the boogeyman we've been told for decades that it is. In fact, it's a critical component to your health. But Jonny, can it be too high?
Anything can be too high. You know, you can die of too much water. You can die of too much oxygen. The fact is that there are much more important risk factors for heart disease, and our obsessive concentration on this one has caused us to take our eye off the ball of the things that really matter. Let me give you an example. It's as if we were attacked on 9/11, and we all got together and said, let's put all our resources into attacking Portugal. Well, maybe there's an Al-Qaeda cell somewhere buried in Portugal, but is that really where you want to focus your attention?
Yeah. But let me ask you this, though. Is there, I guess I'm looking for a figure. Is there a figure as far as your cholesterol count when you would grow concerned?
I would defer that to my cardiologist co-writer, Steve Sinatra. There probably is, but for 99% of the population, the people that are listening to this, we're not talking about extreme values, 1,000 or things like that. We're talking about mildly elevated. And here's the thing, Mark. This is probably the most important take-home point of all. We're measuring cholesterol according to an outdated method. Now, let me just give you a fast history of this. In the 1960s, if you went to a health fair, you'd get a single number for your cholesterol. They'd take a little prick of blood and they'd say, oh, Mr. Jones, you've got a cholesterol of 220 or 190 or 160 or 380 or whatever it was. It was one number. In early 70s, they realized that cholesterol travels in the body in two distinct packages. One is called HDL, one is called LDL, and they behave somewhat differently. So we began to test in terms of good cholesterol and bad cholesterol, HDL and LDL, and that's what we're doing today. That's at least 10 years out of date.
In fact, Jonny, let me interrupt just a second, because I have a listener who wants to ask a question right along those lines, and you can finish. Mary in Dallas is joining us right now. Welcome, Mary. You're with Dr. Jonny Bowden and Mark Taylor. Go right ahead.
Hi. Well, I was wondering what he was going to do about that clarification, because I've always heard you want the HDL as high as you can get it and the LDL as low. And it seems that I have struggled more with weight since I started paying attention to what other people said. I used to be, I didn't realize it, a carbohydrate junkie, but it was not sugar. It was vegetables. It was whole grain pasta. It was sweet potatoes and potatoes. It was those kinds of things, yogurt, things that were not desserts.
Yeah.
And it seemed like I had less trouble. And now since I've tried to do the lower carbs or the different things, because I eat right. I don't eat junk food. I just don't. And I've had more trouble than ever. But this HDL clarification, I didn't know you keep talking about the cholesterol, but I haven't made reference to that. So I was wondering how you're going to clarify that.
Yeah, I'd love to clarify that. So as I was saying, we really now know that there are five different kinds of HDL and at least five different kinds of LDL. And they behave very differently in the body. Now, in LDL, doctors these days simply treat that number. They look at the LDL. But the LDL comes in two flavors, two major flavors. LDL-A, if you look at it under a microscope, looks like a big cotton ball, and it does just as much damage as a cotton ball. If I threw a cotton ball at you, you wouldn't be very injured. The other LDL, LDL-B, is a nasty little bugger. It looks like a BB gun pellet. It's very oxidized, very inflammatory, and it is a problem. If you don't know what kind of LDL you have, you're dealing with an obsolete test. You must, repeat, must, push back and ask your doctor for the newer particle tests. They will tell you what kind of LDL you have. You see, if you have an LDL of 100, most doctors are going to be thrilled. But if most of that LDL 100 is the bad kind, the LDL-B, you're in trouble, even though your doctor thinks you're fine. On the other hand, if you've got an LDL of 150, most doctors are going to reach for the prescription pad in a panic. But if most of that LDL 150 is the LDL-A kind, the cotton ball molecule, you don't need to be treated. So we must go back and get the current tests, which are the particle tests, and stop treating based on an obsolete test that doesn't distinguish between good LDL and bad LDL.
All right, so what's the test called again?
The particle test. You can Google particle test for LDL, and you'll have pages and pages of reading. There are at least four companies that make it. It's sometimes covered by insurance, not always, but that is going to be the way we're going to test cholesterol in the future. It's the only thing that matters when it comes to a cholesterol test.
All right, Dr. Jonny Bowden is with us. The great cholesterol myth. We'll be back with more with Jonny Bowden and more of your phone calls at 1-8-PRAGER-776. Dr. Jonny Bowden is with us. He's a co-author, along with Dr. Stephen Sinatra, of The Great Cholesterol Myth. We were talking, Jonny, a moment ago about the differences in the LDLs, which is really fascinating. But what about HDL? Is this thing we've been told for years, get that up as high as you can, is that as simple as it sounds?
That's generally true, that we do want HDL to be high, even though there is one fraction of HDL that's a little inflammatory. But generally, that's true. The problem is it's almost impossible to do. There's no drug that does it effectively. Niacin works a little bit. But more importantly, let me point something out, because it's very difficult to raise HDL. But what it's not difficult to do at all is to lower triglycerides. Now, if anybody listening to this has their blood test, here's a better predictor for heart disease, for insulin resistance, for diabetes, and even for telling you what kind of LDL you have. You take your triglycerides, you take your HDL, and you figure out the ratio. So, for example, if your triglycerides are 100 and your HDL is 50, your ratio is 2. If your triglycerides are 300 and your HDL is 30, your ratio is 10. If you've got a ratio of 2 or under, 2 or 3, you ain't getting a heart attack. It's just that simple. It's 16 times more predictive than anything else, according to an article in Circulation, which is the Journal of the American Heart Association. So, triglycerides are the real risk factor here. And even if you kept your HDL where it is, if you lowered your triglycerides, your ratio would go down. And that happens every time, not 90% of the time, but every time on a lower carbohydrate diet, because the body makes triglycerides out of carbohydrates, out of sugar.
Yeah, I've been furiously writing this down. So, folks, just I'll tell you how to do this again. You take the triglycerides and the HDL, and you figure out the ratio between the two of them. And according to Jonny, if it's two or under, the ratio is you're not going to have a heart attack.
That's right. And yet doctors will still put you on a statin drug, and that is just insane to me.
Let me go to Susan, who's in Newtown Square, Pennsylvania. Susan, welcome. You're with Mark Taylor and Dr. Jonny Bowden. Go ahead.
Hi, both of you. Dr. Bowden, I'm really interested in your conversation because my husband, who's 71 years old, is having dementia, looks like MCI, mild cognitive impairment, and a memory problem. And there's no history of that in his family whatsoever. On both sides, his family have lived into their 90s. And so I'm wondering, could it have anything to do with the fact that he takes statins? I wonder what your take on it is, because he's not obese, he has no cardiovascular disease in his family, and I tried to have the doctor take him off it last year. He did for 6 weeks, but I don't think that's enough. And I am almost ready to do it myself, but I'm nervous because it gets against the doctor's orders.
Yeah, let me please address that. There are three major side effects with statin drugs. The first is muscle pain and fatigue. The second is memory loss, and the third is loss of libido. There is a former NASA scientist named Dwayne Graveline. He is an MD. He was an astronaut. He was involved in zero gravity conditioning studies. He's certainly no crackpot. A NASA scientist and an MD. When he went on Lipitor, he experienced an extreme form of memory loss called transient global amnesia. It's the most frightening kind of memory loss you can imagine. You can't remember your wife's name. You can't remember where you went to high school. You're not even sure where you live. This happened to Graveline. He wrote a book about it called Lipitor, Thief of Memory. So, yes, you are absolutely right. There is a connection. And let me explain something else. The reason doctors don't recognize this as a side effect, they don't believe their patients that they're related to statin drugs. So someone like your husband will come in and say, Doc, I can't remember my keys. I'm forgetting things left and right. And they'll say, oh, well, you're just getting older. It's a little bit of cognitive impairment. They'll come in and say, I've got muscle pain. I've got all these aches and pains I didn't have before. They say, oh, you're just getting a little bit of arthritis. You're getting older. So doctors don't actually believe that these side effects are related to statin drugs. And we have data on this. There was a fantastic study done out of Stanford in which Beatrice Golomb actually checked with doctors and found that 65% of them do not report these side effects that their patients say are related to the statin drugs because they don't believe they're related to the drugs, but they are. Yes, you are 100% right. And if your husband has no previous cardiovascular disease, no other risk factors, and he's 71, where high cholesterol is actually protective, he has no business on a statin drug.
Okay, 1-8-PRAGER-776, D in Safety Harbor, Florida, with us right now. Hello, D. Welcome.
Hi, Dr. Bowden. I used to receive Dr. Sinatra's newsletters a while back. I don't anymore, but I am into the alternative field, kind of, you know, as a layperson. I have heard that nursing homes are filling up with memory, Alzheimer's / dementia. And we're loaded, much more loaded than we used to be. And I heard that it may be from the low-fat diet because our brain is water and fats. And a lot of people don't even drink much water either.
Yeah.
Is that true?
Yeah, it's close enough for rock and roll. The brain is 60% fat by weight. Most of it is DHA, which is one of the omega-3s, which is why omega-3 supplementation is so important in pregnancy. You've got a developing child and a developing brain that's 60% of this fat. So, yes, there's definitely a correlation. It's fiendishly hard to prove that because, you know, there is a certain amount of cognitive impairment that happens to some people as they get older. But there's very little doubt. If you look with an open, objective eye at the side effects that come from statin drugs, it's very hard to ignore the fact that memory loss is one of the major side effects of statin drugs. There's no question in my mind about that.
Okay. Dr. Bowden, just stick with us, Jonny. We'll be right back. The great cholesterol myth is what we're talking about. And coming back, we have one of us. Who's this? Sue in Glen Mills. We'll get to you. Glen Mills, Pennsylvania, about the diet that Jonny would recommend. And by the way, I would encourage you to read the book because it's loaded with practical things to do that he and Dr. Sinatra believe can keep heart disease at bay. The great cholesterol myth is the name of the book by Dr. Jonny Bowden and Dr. Steven Sinatra. Mark Taylor here for Dennis Prager as we wrap up this hour. We just have a few more minutes. Let's go right to the phones. And Sue is in Glen Mills, Pennsylvania, joining us right now with Dr. Jonny Bowden. Hello, Sue.
Dr. Bowden, I have your book in my hand. I haven't opened it yet. And I've had insulin-dependent diabetes since I'm 17 for 50 years. Mm-hmm. So I've always tried to watch the carbohydrates, fat, and protein and make them as healthy as possible. Mm-hmm. But I had a question also. I keep fighting with my doctors about this particle test, and they don't want to order it for me. And these are educated men and women, endocrinologists, and PhDs, and they say, no, it's bogus, you don't need it, and I keep insisting on it. So I'm going to see a cardiologist, and they say their practice uses the particle test, which I think Dennis's cardiologist, Dr. Michael Richman in California, also promotes, because we really need to get accurate, truthful cholesterol management in order to decide what diet, whatever, needs to be authorized. So I appreciate that very much. And what is your feeling about coconut oil?
I love coconut oil. It's a very healthy food. In my book, The 150 Healthiest Foods on Earth, I gave it a star. It's antiviral. It's antimicrobial. It's good for the immune system. The body tends to use the fat in coconut oil as energy rather than as storage fat. It's a great food. And I'm glad you brought that up, because I'd actually like to speak a little bit about a heart-healthy eating program and supplementation program, because these are things we can actually do something about, and they don't require tremendous changes in our lifestyle. The foods that we recommend in the book, things like wild salmon, which is loaded with omega-3s, the most anti-inflammatory molecule on the planet, fresh blueberries, which, by the way, are available all year round, especially even now because they come from Chile. They're little blue dynamos. They have anti-inflammatories. They're high in fiber, low in sugar, absolutely wonderful food. Grass-fed beef is another wonderful food. Almost everything in the fruit and vegetable kingdom is loaded with anti-inflammatories and
Jonny, let me interrupt you for a second. Let me ask you a question, because we're running out of time, and you hit something I want to ask you about. I've sometimes had a hard time finding grass-fed beef, so what I've gone to, and I want to ask you if this works as well, is lamb, which almost all of it is grass-fed. Is that a good substitute?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
That's a very healthy meat, and it is almost always grass-fed. You're absolutely right.
Listen, Jonny, we're out of time. Okay. We could do hours on this. You are a needed voice. This is a needed book, and I'm convinced it's going to help people live a longer, healthier life, called The Great Cholesterol Myth. And not only do you expose these myths, you do, in this book, give a lot of, you were going into it now, the kind of foods and the kind of lifestyle that will help you combat heart disease. Right?
Exactly.
Okay. Well, Dr. Jonny Bowden, it was a real pleasure. Look forward to talking to you again in the future. Thank you, sir.